In the fall of 2005, about 6 weeks after Hurricane Katrina made landfall, I arrived in New Orleans.
This for the news hour.
I'd been covering education for 30 years, but I was not prepared for what I encountered.
I think I saw you in the paper. It said, God answered my prayer.
Yeah. I'm not a particularly religious person. That's just one of my asides. No, God didn't answer my prayers. I think that we got lucky.
We got lucky? Hurricane Katrina and the flooding caused nearly 2,000 deaths and over $100 billion in damages. 65,000 New Orleans students and their teachers had been displaced and were scattered across the country. Why, in the midst of this tragedy, were some saying we got lucky?
The storm has come through and done the damage. Look at what we can take from that, what we can use it for. It's a tool.
Those who wanted drastic change saw this as an opportunity. Hurricane Katrina had shut down the city of New Orleans, and with it, its schools, long considered among the worst in the nation. The greatest experiment in the history of American education was about to begin.
What's the message you suppose the kids get when they come to a school like this?
I remember filming in the schools 10 years before Katrina. Even then, they were falling apart. Schools had computers, but not enough power to run them. But bad as the schools were physically, they were worse academically. The year before Hurricane Katrina hit, not even one-third of eighth graders could pass a state reading test. In some schools, only 4%.
There was a high school student named Bridget Green. Basically, she had, at that point, failed the graduation exit exam, I want to say, 4 times. Meanwhile, she was the valedictorian of the high school, meaning she had the highest GPA in the high school. So I went to talk to the school, and the principal basically said, well, you know, sometimes it happens.
They passed you alone. I figured that out after he missed about 20 days, and he got all A's. Well, who class were you in? I'm like, you got all A's, and you weren't in class, but they passed him alone.
People keep blaming the children. They blame the families. We are telling these young people they are doing A work, and they are functionally illiterate.
I would venture to say we were potentially one of the worst districts in the nation.
Corruption ran deep.
You had 8 superintendents in 10 years. You had massive fraud beginning up at the top. And the FBI had opened up an office in the central office building.
We had documented cases of people that were putting in 50 hours of overtime a week. 50 hours a week every week of the year. Including Christmas.
Dead people getting paychecks. Teachers not getting paid.
Just years and years and years of abuse. People just doing what they wanted to do.
How do you resolve this depth of corruption, this depth of disenfranchisement, these deep feelings of inadequacy? Like, how do you resolve that in a system that has to keep going? And so I used to think that, like, if only there could just be, like, you know, a few months where there was just no school, right? And then Katrina happens, right? And you're kind of like, well, there you go.
In November 2005, less than 3 months after the storm, while most New Orleanians were still displaced, lawmakers in the state capitol took action.
The House and Senate voted late yesterday to approve Louisiana Governor Kathleen Blanco's proposal for the state to take over schools in New Orleans.
The state constitution guarantees every child a free education. when local communities fail, and fail utterly, the state must step in.
Louisiana seized control of over 100 of New Orleans' failing schools, nearly 90% of the entire district, and placed them in the state-run recovery school district.
I will present the academic plan and members.
The plan was for the state to fix these schools and eventually return them to the local school board. New Orleans teachers and their union wanted to be part of the reforms.
Yeah, I would just hope that the partners that you have here, United Teachers of New Orleans, is also part of that discussion.
But within months, all 8,000 New Orleans teachers and other public school employees received pink slips.
It was devastating, to say the least, after going through probably one of the worst natural and then we also classified human disasters in our country, Hurricane Katrina, coming back and trying to get your lives together and think that at least there's some stability on the horizon if you at least have a workplace to go to in. And that just wasn't the case in this case.
With no teachers and no staff, the New Orleans public school system was completely dismantled. And with the bulk of the district now in the hands of the state and students beginning to return to the city, the future was very much in doubt. December 14th, 2005. Much of the city is still deserted. O. Perry Walker High School, one of the few school buildings to escape serious damage, is about to reopen.
Hopefully never, ever again in the history of this country, and I'd venture in the world, will any group of folk be given an opportunity because of a Katrina or some other natural disaster. But the reality is we have this opportunity and we need to seize this moment.
We have to be on our toes when the kids come in. And you set the stage. We all know that from teaching. If you've taught 1 month, you know that the first day sets the stage.
Some of us as teachers, we're gonna wanna go back the way it was done before. A lot of the children, you know, gonna be expecting things to look like they did before. And it's just gonna be interesting how we can create a new vision of what who we are and what we wanna be.
Walker was reopening as a public charter school. This meant it was no longer controlled by the local school board. Although publicly funded, it would be privately run, more like a small business. And like a business, O. Perry Walker Charter School had a bottom line: to educate its students. If it failed to do that, it could lose its charter and be shut down. It was a far cry from the old way of running schools.
We were slaves to the old system, but the shackles have been removed from us. So now we are free. We are free to do the things that we need to do as teachers to educate. I feel free.
In the next 2 months, a dozen more schools reopened, most of them as charter schools. Principals and teachers enjoyed their new freedom.
You know the policy and procedure manuals from Orleans Parish? I actually threw it away.
But starting over would prove to be hard work.
The challenge in New Orleans, which really gets lost to people, is you weren't just trying to turn around a failing school district. You had to rebuild the entire school and city infrastructure. We were flying, designing, and building the plane simultaneously.
Leslie Jacobs, then on the State Board of Education, and her colleagues were designing their new school system around an idea, charter schools, known as much for their failures as their successes. Since charter schools began in 1992, they had rarely performed better than traditional public schools. There have been cases of corruption and mismanagement, some leading to felony convictions. Jacobs believed that the cause of the failures was a flawed chartering process. It had been just too easy to get a charter.
You had to be very careful that you had to have high standards. And if you opened the door wide to people who might have a good heart, you know, but don't really know how to run things, that'll be a mistake.
To set a high bar, Louisiana hired Greg Richmond of the National Association of Charter School Authorizers to vet applicants.
In the fall of 05, when I first went down there, I met with the former state superintendent of schools, Cecil Picard, in his office. And Cecil was from rural Louisiana, traditional educator, pretty skeptical of this charter school idea. And I told him, we're very supportive of charter schools, but we have very high standards for who we approve. We turn down about 4 out of 5 of the applicants that come to us. And he said to me, that's what I want you to do here.
There were 44 new charter applicants. Of those 44, only 6 were approved.
The plan was to reopen most schools in the recovery school district as charters. But setting the bar high, insisting on quality, had an unintended consequence. The district couldn't open charter schools fast enough to handle all the returning students. And so state bureaucrats found themselves trying to run schools.
It's unorganized. They don't have nothing that you're supposed to have in 10th grade.
For whatever reason, I don't understand what takes so long to ship books, but they didn't plan it well enough to have books here for the kids.
In 2006 and 2007, you still didn't have buildings, textbooks, and teachers.
When I visited Rob Wynn High School, one of the schools the state was running, there was still no heating, and students and teachers wore winter jackets inside. On some days, lunch was served in the courtyard, a precaution against the rats that had invaded the cafeteria.
Do you think things are now going to get better?
No, it's getting worse. They trying to say it like it's coming better. It's getting worse.
It had taken nearly 2 years, but by the fall of 2007, New Orleans seemed to be coming back. More than 30,000 of the original 65,000 students had returned. 80 public schools had reopened, half of them charter schools. And the recovery school district had a new superintendent.
Let me tell you, I was the first to get a college diploma in my family, and of course, I was a special education student for about 6 years. I was a starter and stammer, almost dropped out of high school, had to go to community college to get my grades up. My mother never once said, you're not going to college. Never once said you're not going to college. In fact, told all my brothers and sisters that you're all going to college. Now, she set that bar high, and if you set the bar high, the higher you set it, the higher the children are gonna perform.
Paul Vallis came to New Orleans from Philadelphia. I met him before that, when he was running the schools in Chicago. He worked well with unions, embraced charter schools, and liked to take chances.
So, you know, you wanna become a civil rights leader, become a teacher. You wanna get involved in the greatest chapter in the American Civil Rights Movement, dedicate yourself to the education of our young people.
Many from outside New Orleans heard the call.
I just graduated Princeton University.
I went to school at Texas Tech University.
I just graduated from Yale University.
I woke up one morning and I said, I have to go to New Orleans.
Young idealists from all around the country moved to New Orleans to join the reform movement. Many from organizations like Teach for America. TFA recruits recent college graduates to teach for a minimum of 2 years. Paul Vallis welcomed them with open arms.
These young people come with so much energy and so much dynamism, and they're so optimistic. They have such high expectations and high hopes, and I want to seize on that.
Vallis replaced teachers who had lost their jobs when the state took over with hundreds of these first-time teachers. This decision was unpopular with many in the community.
It doesn't make sense. No more than I would want a mechanic who's never worked on a car to fix my engine, would I want a teacher who's never taught a child to teach my child. I mean, how many people would go in the hospital and say, give me the brand new doctor who's never done surgery? That's the one I want to operate on my heart, because he has more energy than that old doctor who's been doing it for 20 years. Nobody goes and says that.
I don't know any industry that doesn't welcome new talent.
Sarah Houston, herself a product of Teach for America, was instrumental in helping Vallis hire more TFA teachers. She created the influential nonprofit New Schools for New Orleans.
I do deeply believe you need to have young talent. And what's most important is what happens when they are in a classroom with kids.
But what happens in classrooms is only part of the story, especially in New Orleans.
You're throwing a lot of young, naive, bright-eyed people into a situation with kids from New Orleans who are poor, who are hungry, who were born addicted to drugs, who don't have anywhere to live, whose parents sent them back to New Orleans and they're living by themselves. They're working. They got to go pick up their little brother from school, so they need to leave at 3 o'clock, even though school ends at 4:15. Those are the kind of problems that and the things that these new teachers don't know about. It's not the instruction. Instruction for teachers is only a small part of the teaching job.
For first-year TFA recruit Katie Amundson from the University of Tennessee, the challenges began on day one when a computer glitch scrambled student schedules.
Literally everyone kept coming in and saying, I have your class, I have your class, I have your class. And I'm thinking, how in the world do I have 40 kids that have biology fifth period?
He's on my schedule somewhere. Wait a minute.
It took the school 6 weeks to get it right. Another TFA recruit faced his own challenges.
Before I go on, everyone familiar with the leader? Raise your hand. Give me a thumbs up if you're familiar with the leader. Thumbs down if you're not.
Yale graduate Daniel Hoffman made a common rookie mistake on his first day.
I need everyone to give me either a thumbs up or a thumbs down.
He asked his students to demonstrate what they did not know.
Look, I need to know where we are so that, okay.
First day was pretty miserable. I had a lot of trouble keeping kids on task, keeping them focused. I just felt totally drained.
All right.
Yeah, that's cool. That's
Katie Amundson seemed to be a natural.
That is really cool. I love that. I love my students. They're great. They're so interesting, and they come from a completely different background than me, and they bring a lot to the class, and they're really energetic. We got to catch you up because you weren't here yesterday.
However, her greatest test lay ahead. Could she get through to students like Brittany Jackson?
I'm 19. I've been a senior. This is my third year as a senior. Sometimes it hurt to say that this is my third year, but it took a lot of strife for me to come back to school at 19 years old. I could have just dropped out.
Brittany was not an exception in New Orleans. In 2007, 85% of students were performing below grade level.
Brittany's a student that I really want to see graduate, and so I'm definitely invested. She doesn't give up, and she knows what she wants, and so that says a lot about her.
To get her diploma, Brittany had to pass at least one more section of the state graduation test, which she said she had already failed a dozen times.
You think she'll make it?
I think she's definitely going to pass biology if she doesn't just disappear on me.
We need to move now. We need to start building buildings now. We need to modernize those classrooms now.
We took Paul Vallis to come in and break up the whole central office strategy, eliminate command and control, create competition, and use this idea of charter schools as a jump start. That idea of reform, I think, is not only a good idea for taking over the lowest achieving schools, but I think will prove to be the idea for how public schools should operate in the 21st century.
But we opened the school year with, I believe, 6 new operational charter schools. I envision in the next 3 to 4 years, all of the schools will be chartered.
Why is that a good thing?
Well, I'm a believer in schools having the freedom and autonomy to make decisions that are in the best interests of the children. And so I support charter schools because charter schools are a vehicle for achieving that type of freedom.
By 2009, more than half of the New Orleans public schools were charters, each free to set its own course. Where are the boys?
Oh.
This class don't have boys because we, if they had boys, more girls would be focused on boys than their work.
It's way easier. When you have boys in your class, you feel like you gotta put your attention on them. Like, you gotta be, like, trying to impress them. But if you just in school with some girls and they're your friends, you just not worrying about it, you know?
Girls are a distraction.
Yeah, at times, not all the time.
The decision to separate girls and boys was made by the school's principal.
As principal of a charter school, you are responsible for everything.
What's this?
You have to make sure the lunch is being served on time and the food is ordered, and you have to make sure the curriculum is intact and research-based and standards are met and teachers are hired and teachers are paid, grants are written.
When you were principal of regular school?
I didn't have to do any of that.
Good lesson today.
From the beginning, charter school principals have hired and fired their own staff. Unions are rarely in the picture.
Before, when we were under Orleans Parish, it might be a large group of teachers that had the same concern. And we could go to the union and then we'd have that large voice. Well, now with us in different little pockets and we have different concerns, you know, there's really no need for the union like we needed it before.
We're filling in the blanks, y'all.
Today, only about 20% of New Orleans teachers are members of the union. The majority of them work in traditional public schools. One particular brand of charter school quickly took root in New Orleans. This school is part of the KIPP National Network. KIPP, which stands for Knowledge is Power Program, was started by two former TFA Corps members and now has 9 schools in New Orleans.
I know you're ready because your eyes will be just on me. Thank you so much.
Like all KIPP schools, KIPP believe college prep is defined by high expectations and a strict school culture. Students arrive at 7:30 and stay until 4:30. They have Saturday school and lots of homework. Music matters at KIPP. Every student learns to play an instrument. And relentlessly, the focus is on college.
I want to go to Howard University, and I want to be a guidance counselor.
I want to be a doctor, and I want to go to Tulane University.
I want to go to the University of Florida and be a professional football player.
I want to be a veterinarian. I want to go to Princeton University.
In KIPP classrooms, unorthodox teaching is the norm.
The first time I came to a meeting here, I'm gonna tell you the truth, I was like, what kind of crap is this Bojangle? You know, what are they doing? I am not gonna be a part of this, you know? And so when I really got it, when I seen that Summer got it that way, I said, well, that's the process. The process is to get it. This year she got to comprehend what she's reading to where she's reading things all around the house. She loves it. She absolutely loves it.
Nearly 80% of students at KIPP believe passed the state reading and math tests. That makes it the highest performing middle school in the Recovery School District. At this charter high school, discipline comes first. Students are required to toe the line.
If they walk in here and see this right now, this would be a demerit. If they see that right there, right now, that red, that little bitty red right there, that's a demerit.
Bobby Calvin is in his second year at Psy Academy.
You would be sent home if you have a blue sock on. You would be sent home for the day. And I look at that like that's just a problem that just don't even have to be that.
So your shoes cannot have gray on them. They have to be all white or all black.
Putting your head on your desk, wearing the wrong color socks, not walking properly in the hallways, all of these earn demerits, which can lead to detention, suspension, and expulsion.
It's easy to get demerits for little things because we want the conversation really to stop at the little things. Teenagers need to rebel. That's obvious. Adults need to pay attention to the way in which they're rebelling.
Markovitz moved to New Orleans after earning a degree from the Harvard Graduate School of Education. He opened Psy Academy in 2008 when he was only 27 years old.
What I would say is non-negotiable and never changes is our goal of getting all our students ready for college success.
Before the end of its first year, Psy Academy students were testing at the top of the district. But not every charter school has been successful. When a charter school in New Orleans fails to deliver on its promises, there are consequences. Charter schools that opened after Hurricane Katrina had 5 years to meet achievement and attendance goals. The group running Harriet Tubman Elementary didn't make it. Its charter was revoked. 7 other charter schools have met the same fate.
New Orleans has the advantage where they can take away the charter of a failing school and give it to a better operator. That's often not the case in other cities.
And that's just what happened with Harriet Tubman Elementary. Almost immediately, a new charter for the school was granted to another group. It was now up to Kate Mihok and her team, Crescent City Schools, to prove they could do better.
We're excited to be part of a system that holds schools accountable. And so like charters before us that are held accountable and need to meet benchmarks, we are very comfortable being in that same light. We have 5 years. If we don't meet our benchmarks, you should shut us down as well.
A former Teach for America teacher who had also been an assistant principal at a KIPP charter school in New York City, Mihok moved to New Orleans for this opportunity.
There's a lot that has happened in a week, even though it will look like we're gonna paint, and we'll fix the lighting, we'll make sure the air conditioners work, we'll make sure that there's no leaks coming. Wow, there's a lot of stuff.
There are times sometimes where I'm like, there's a lot of people to blame for why we have to do this work. But at the same time, people have probably been blaming other people for years, and that's why the work hasn't gotten done. So right now, it's our school, it's our job. Let's make it happen. All right, we'll be ready.
Just blocks away, staff training for Mihok's new school was underway. Overseeing the training was Principal Julie Lauzet.
All together.
With our actions, we make this school safe for everyone to learn and grow.
The entire staff was brand new. More than 40% were current or former members of Teach for America or similar programs.
Do what is right, even when it's hard.
We joke about drinking the Kool-Aid, and it's sort of shorthand for, you know, join in the team and really be a part of it.
Fixing up the building and training teachers were only part of the job.
I think when you walk in, you'll see Harriet Tubman. You'll see that we're doing.
There was one more critical piece.
What I'm looking for is safety.
The school day, how long is the school day?
What's available for children with ADHD?
Good academics, good activities.
She just needs to be able to go to school and get the best education possible.
At the annual Schools Expo, families explore their educational options.
80 schools will be here, public, traditional, and charter. Parents will be able to apply to as many schools as possible for next year.
What is y'all's student teacher ratio?
25 to 1.
While schools make their best sales pitch.
We've had the highest gains for 2 years running.
It's a combination middle high school.
We have a basketball team that's won 2 championships.
We give all of our students our phone numbers.
We broke up the monopoly. We're going to create competition.
There you go, man. Now you're a part of the family.
And if they operate well, we're actually going to give them more schools to operate. And if they operate poorly, we're going to put them out of business.
Kate Mihok had inherited the Harriet Tubman building, but not the kids. Now she had just 4 months to enroll 450 students.
We have a lot of students to recruit. And so every child that comes to the door is a potential child that could come into your building. And so when they're talking to other people, you want them all to talk to you, want them all to come to your school.
By the end of year 6, 70% of students were attending charter schools. Academically, the district was improving faster than any other in Louisiana.
We went up in every grade, in every subject.
Before Katrina, 2/3 of students, of high school students, went to a failing
high school. Last year, it was less than a third.
The country was paying attention.
This community has actually used the crisis as an opportunity to try to experiment with new ways of learning.
School districts in Connecticut, Michigan, Tennessee, and elsewhere were eager to believe that charter schools could fix their floundering school systems. But for many in New Orleans, it wasn't that simple. The charter movement was creating a divide. Critics like Lance Hill were saying, hold on, not so fast.
The education reform movement in New Orleans, as it unfolded, has become a two-tiered school system of haves and have-nots.
About 69% of students in the state-run charter high schools passed the state math test in 2011, a huge improvement. However, in the non-charter schools, only 33% of students passed. That's lower than pre-Katrina. Political scientist Hill and others saw a conspiracy. They accused charter schools of deliberately excluding students who were likely to bring down test scores.
By allowing charters to have a separate disciplinary code, which permits them to expel students who are low-performing students. We have created some excellent schools, but we do it by creating even worse schools. We advantage one student by disadvantaging another student.
There are charter schools that are misusing their independence to select a certain crop of kids to go to their school. I think that's a shame.
Some suggested that Ben Markovitz's school, Psi Academy, had been gaming the system. Markovitz denied the charge.
There are rules in schools, and there is a handbook in our school, and we ultimately have to uphold the integrity of our discipline policies. So we've had kids that we've had to ask to leave, but currently I believe we are working with all kids, and if it seems in any way that we're not, we want to know about that.
Markovitz says he never purposely got rid of unwanted students. But if a school wanted to cheat, he says, it would be easy.
If there is a withdrawal, it doesn't flag or register centrally the way an expulsion does. So you actually create opportunities for people to game the system, where they can say, as long as children are withdrawing and not being expelled, my school never gets flagged for pushing kids who have significant or specific problems out of the school.
Now, the important concept here is that the low-performing, high-needs, challenging students don't just disappear. Where are they? Dumping schools. They are public schools where all the students who couldn't get in the charters or couldn't stay in the charters are now concentrated in these other schools. And in those schools, no learning takes place whatsoever.
You're taking a quiz. Bring me your quiz. No, bring me your quiz.
You come into class, falling asleep, not paying attention, taking things for a joke.
How do we find our numerator for right here?
And I got a class full of 26 to 28 students, and only one or two are really interested in learning.
The greatest challenge we face is the fact that our kids are so old, so much older than they should be at that grade level, and so far behind. I'm talking about 16, 17-year-old 8th graders, 18-year-old 9th graders who are 2, 3, 4 years below grade level academically.
Booker T. Washington is one of the alternative schools Vallis opened for overage and behaviorally challenged students. His hope was to transition them back to a regular school, preferably a charter school.
Most of the students here say this is just a prison, a detention center. And they don't look at it like this is a school. Sometimes it feels like they just put all the kids who are troubled to other schools here.
A lot of the students tend to get jaded. You've experienced failure for so many times that there's a point of where you just accept it's not worth even trying.
It's just something that you go through. You don't feel, you feel like school is just a waste of time. You don't want to do it no more. Everybody that thought that probably still thinking that.
What grade are you in?
I'm in 8th.
And you're supposed to be in?
11.
When we went back to re-interview Antoine Duplessis, he had dropped out. We couldn't find him, and no one in the district had any information about his whereabouts. Antoine's case illustrates a consequence of having a system of independent schools, with no central office keeping track of enrollments. or making sure that every school has a fair discipline policy, it was easy for students to fall through the cracks.
The system of schools tracking things like dropout and expulsion has a long way to go to really actually give clear data on what's happening.
He is a great kid, sweet, he's bright. He's on the autism spectrum. He's pretty fragile medically. He's got a bone marrow failure syndrome and spinal cord disorder too. So he uses a wheelchair.
Sue Bordelon's son, Clark, is 17.
The first time we went and applied at a charter school after Katrina, what I heard was, we can't accommodate him. And this was repeated over and over at every charter school we went to. We were told no.
We heard similar complaints from other parents. But if charter schools were discouraging special needs students from enrolling, where were they going?
I have every exceptionality for special education, autistic children, blind kids, hearing impaired kids, kids with severe physical handicaps.
A's and B's, congratulations.
Sherilyn Branch was principal of Benjamin Banneker Elementary School, not a charter school. When I visited Banneker Elementary in 2009, 15% of the kids there were special needs. By contrast, New Orleans charter schools enrolled on average 7% special needs students. Statistically, it's virtually impossible for that discrepancy to occur by chance.
I get referrals from specific principals of charter schools. Go to Banneker, tell Ms. Branch I sent you. Go to Banneker.
It should be okay.
Why aren't you blowing the whistle? Why aren't you naming names? That's Jones Charter or Smith Charter.
Actually, I don't think there's any principal in the district who hasn't said to Ms. DeVallis, look, this is what's going on. Why aren't we doing something about it?
She is constantly ringing my ear about the fact that they get a disproportionate number of kids. You know, there are a lot of schools, charter and non-charter, that try to discourage perhaps some of the more challenged kids from going to their school or going to somewhere else. There are some schools that don't believe that they have the capacity to serve every kid who comes through the door.
Money is the heart of the issue. In a traditional school district, costs for special needs students can be spread across schools. Three schools might share an autism specialist, for example. But a charter school is on its own, and special needs students are expensive to educate. In 2010, the Southern Poverty Law Center filed a suit against the State Department of Education on behalf of students with disabilities.
We realized that the problem wasn't with individual schools or with individual parents. It was really a design flaw. There was a structural problem in place that the system simply just could not adequately address the needs of students with disabilities in New Orleans. You can have charter schools who have amazing innovations and amazing strengths that are also capable of providing for students that have a range of special needs. It doesn't need to be one or the other.
The lawsuit has really been like, in some ways, the catalyst that the state needed in order to continue on that path that we were on.
Patrick Dobart, who became superintendent in 2012, has promised to meet the challenge head on.
We were trying to really put things in place that were going to transform the special needs programs.
Are you saying the lawsuit did you a favor? It was a wake-up call?
I think in some instances, absolutely, I would say that.
The lawsuit remains open. At Psy Academy, Principal Ben Markovitz was determined to have students adapt to his code of conduct, but it wasn't working. He was losing too many students. Midway through the school year, he tried something new.
They got three men dressed in suits. I thought they was cops. I thought they was police.
I know it's probably a little scary, like, wait, hold on, they po-po or what? Well, no, no. We definitely are not the police.
Okay. 17 young men, on the verge of being kicked out or dropping out, were assigned to Khalil Osiris's mentoring program, Circle of Courage.
Let's see, Frank, how many years you serve in prison?
I did 13 and a half in Angola.
Amir, how many years you serve in prison?
I served 1 year as a juvenile for murder and 5 years for an adult.
How old was you when you committed the murder?
I was 14 years old.
I served 20 years in prison. What? I served the most time in prison of everybody here.
What you did?
Robbery and fraud by credit transfer.
Damn.
Me. I made some bad choices very early on, and my sons had to grow up without me being there with them. The primary reason that Psy Academy has allowed for us to be at this school is because there are students here who simply are struggling to fit into this culture. Some of the students have never been in an environment as structured as this.
This lane is not moving. The inside lanes are.
Many of the children have never been in an environment where the academic expectations are so high.
What?
And with a teacher core that's predominantly white, to make that adjustment is not easy. We're gonna make it work for us together. And we're gonna come away from this experience completely transformed for the good.
For the rest of the year, these students would participate in classes and in one-on-one sessions with the goals of improving their behavior and their grades, essentially to keep them in school.
Circle of Courage is just like the only place in school that you can just go and just talk and just let each other know your problems and hear each other out. And like just to hear what Khalil and all the other guys have to say, it'd be like real inspirational.
That ain't gonna change what you're going through. What you can change is the way you respond to what you're going through. You can change.
More people go to prison per capita in Louisiana than any other state in the nation. So if students don't succeed in school, if they don't stay in school, we have a clear picture of what's going to become of the majority of them. They're going to end up in a criminal culture. They're going to end up engaged in crime, violence, and imprisonment. They're going to end up, or they're going to end up dead. So there's a lot at stake.
Right. 6 weeks later, nearly half of the students in Circle of Courage had been suspended.
Can you just tell me your thinking, why that has happened?
Speak from the heart.
I mean, just from your heart, from what you see and what you know about the school, what you know that's going on, because you know it better than almost anybody else.
I don't know, man. Like I always stress, it ain't hard to not get in. I mean, it's not hard to get in trouble here. It's easy to walk right out the door and get in trouble.
Right.
It's not hard. Like, when I think about it, I just be like, man, that might not be the place for me.
Right. But I'm saying, but this is the thing that gets me about you. Every time we ask the question about what is it that you need to do to be successful here, you always say the right thing. You know everything that you need to do to be successful.
Yeah.
So there's no reason for you not to be successful here.
Last week of school. Now what?
By the last meeting, only 4 of the original 17 showed up. Among those missing was Bobby Calvin. Bobby had been expelled because he had accumulated too many demerits, most of them before he was assigned to Circle of Courage.
Circle of Courage kind of came a little late in the school year. It came like the last quarter. When I did decide to settle down, I forgot about these problems I had built up. So it was just one little thing I'd do and I was out.
What had gone wrong? Why wouldn't the young men get with the program? School leader Andre Perry said it wasn't entirely the students' fault.
We're building policy around control of black children and the problem of black children. When I walk into schools and I see, white lines painted everywhere, people don't realize that while they're asking kids to walk along a white line so that they can have a sense of discipline and order, that same white line is painted in prison.
Sit down.
Culturally, that's just insensitive. When you're so ideological, you say, oh, this school unit just done this and it's proven successful, that's what we're going to do, right? No, that doesn't necessarily mean it's right.
That issue, cultural insensitivity, was front and center for many in the community.
So many major decisions have been made that have been really shoved down our throat as a community. My main concern is that the charter movement does not emanate from the community up. We talk about wanting families to be involved, but our charter law here in Louisiana does not require any of these new charters coming in to engage families or engage the community. That's a problem.
The mass layoff of veteran teachers right after Katrina was still a festering sore 6 years later.
I'm very troubled to hear that most of the positions hired for this upcoming school year will be held by Teach for America teachers.
The replacements, most of them young, most of them outsiders, most of them white.
You have A, B, and C, right?
Included Teach for America core members Katie Amundson and Daniel Hoffman.
It has not been easy.
Man, it's C because he's
hold on.
Classroom management is my biggest challenge.
I had met a few TFA teachers like Daniel, idealistic but naive, determined to fix an awful situation but not sure how.
A lot of these kids are kids who have seen murder. They've seen Katrina. They've been, in a lot of ways, been through much worse than I've ever seen and hopefully ever will see. And so there's almost nothing that they're scared of.
What class are you supposed to be in?
Dealing with that when I'm supposed to be in a position of authority.
Alan.
In some ways, my hands are tied.
Let me out.
Have you gotten tougher?
What are you telling me for?
If anything, I've become a little bit more lax in order to keep my own sanity. And it's something I definitely shouldn't be doing.
All right, let me take a step back.
I did see improvement with Daniel, but I'm not sure that this job is for everyone. I'm not sure that everyone can come here and do well in this job, and he's one who really, really struggled.
At the end of his first year, Daniel was let go.
Tell me, if you would, how you reacted and you had that conversation with the principal.
It was tough. It was tough. Because I knew things hadn't gone well, and I knew that there was some amount of displeasure with how things had gone, but I thought that there would be a little more of a chance.
Daniel Hoffman is an exception. Teach for America says that 90% of its recruits finished their 2-year commitment.
Excellent.
Daniel didn't give up on education. He's now teaching at a private school in Tennessee. And Katie Amundson?
Brittany?
One student in particular had been weighing on her mind.
It's been tough with Brittany. She just hasn't come to school a lot.
Brittany Jackson, the third-year senior, was working, sometimes 70 hours a week. School had taken a back seat.
I see that mentality a lot. Like, I could be at work right now and I'm sitting in your class. It was really hard to reason with her. Like, this is why you need to be in my class. Like, this is what's gonna help you really in the future, because to her, the paycheck was way more important.
Focus, don't distract her.
Ms. Amundson is taking time out to make sure I come to school or to make sure I have extra makeup work that I'm having work when I go home or when I get off from work.
How has your attendance been?
I try to do the best I can. I just asked Ms. Amundson to bear with me right now.
In the spring, Brittany showed up to take the exam she needed to pass to graduate. the one she had failed so many times before.
Brittany M. Jackson.
You just feel relieved after you get a high school diploma because I know that my dreams won't stop. My dreams don't go forward.
Courtney, what do you think that is? Mitosis or meiosis?
6 years in, Katie is still teaching in New Orleans. We met other TFA teachers like Katie.
Let's do it.
Flexible, dedicated, and often willing to commit beyond the usual 2 years. In fact, one-third of students in Greater New Orleans are taught by current or former Teach for America members, more than in any other part of the country.
Excellence, then, is a habit.
Superintendent Patrick Dobard remains committed to Teach for America, but recognizes that its predominantly white middle-class members must also be ready to learn.
Someone once told me, oh, I don't want Biff and Buffy teaching my kids. And I said, I'm fine with Biff and Buffy teaching them. But one of the things, if I need to teach and help them understand how you can relate better to an urban and inner city kid in New Orleans, why don't we bring members from that community to mentor, to talk with them and work together and take someone's maybe weaknesses and help make it a strength with someone from the community?
After the disappointing results of Circle of Courage, Psi Academy principal Ben Markovitz made some changes.
We found ourselves sort of tragically stuck with nothing more than stuff like suspension, stuff that got kids out of school. We took a look at that this summer and said, that's just not what we want to do. It's not what we want to be. So what used to be a demerit is now a ton of praise in the opposite direction. So the actual path to something like suspension or expulsion is much, much longer. And that's something we thought we had in place. We thought we had a long path to those things, but we really didn't.
Bobby Calvin, who had been expelled, was given a second chance.
I wouldn't have passed the graduate exit exam if I was in SI Academy. I passed the test. I passed both parts. I passed the MAT with a mastery, and I passed the English language arts with a basic. So I'm ready to graduate.
And what you do for number six?
If you're not in school, if you're not trying to get in school, if you're not enrolled in school, there's a slim chance of possibility for you right now. It's slim.
She says the bus never came.
Today was the first day of school. We're really excited. We've been working in the building for about 8 weeks.
It definitely came down to the wire. I think it was a 1 a.m. last night. But there are 550 kids out there and about 150 parents, and it was totally orderly. There are moments you have to step back and go, oh my Lord, look what we just did. Here we are on the first day of school, and we have done this.
Before the storm, the New Orleans school system had 65,000 students in 129 schools, and it was awful. 8 years after Katrina, New Orleans has a system of schools, not a school system. It's smaller, about 43,000 students in just 87 schools. 90% of them are public charter schools. Test scores continue to rise, dropout rates are down, and graduation rates are improving. But even with the improvement, New Orleans still has some of the lowest performing schools in the state, and more than one-third of students are failing. While more kids have more educational opportunities, there's much more to be done.
New Orleans will have the best urban school district in the United States in years to come. We are transforming what was an absolutely failed system. We still have an incredibly long way to go. We've come great distances, but this is hard, hard work.
Will the changes last?
You can't turn them back. The great thing about this system is it's really going to be hard to dismantle what's been created.
No one has a permanent entitlement to run a school. You've got to deliver. And if you don't deliver, someone else is going to be given that license to do that. I think that is how our public education system can run, all of it.
People have finally realized that economic tragedy is fueled in part by the failure of public schools to operate and function. It's time for us to get off our dead asses and do something about it.
A gift
that I feel really blessed from Katrina is I feel completely released from the notion of waiting for any entity to do something. If you are a neighborhood around a school and you want to change it, organize yourselves and do it.
However, doubts remain. Are math and reading scores an adequate measure of success?
The goal of reform is not to increase test scores. It's to graduate folks from college, give folks the ability to have a job. If we're not improving the basic life outcomes of these kids and their families, then what the heck are we doing?
What year are you going to college?
2019. Some of you may come away from this film thinking that charter schools are the answer to education's problems, the magic bullet. Right now. Not true. Charter schools have been the vehicle for improvement here, but the keys have been hard work, high standards, integrity, cooperation, and a willingness to learn from mistakes. 8 years in, no one is ready to declare victory. What we call the greatest experiment in the history of American public education is working, but it has a long way to go.
I want to be a veterinarian. I want to go to Princeton University. Get a degree in business.
No less than the tree in the star. You have a right to be here.
Snapping in class is a way to signify that you agree or that you like something that's being said or done.